Welcome to New Life Presbyterian Church, where our mission is to bless, bloom, become. We are a vibrant, multi-generational, and inclusive community of believers who seek to illuminate light and spread love and liberation for all God's children through prophetic preaching and Bible-based teaching. It is our quest to serve as a bold witness to the power of Christ through activism, evangelism, and servant leadership in all that we do. We welcome you to today's service. Thank you for worshiping with us. Have a blessed week. New Life. Mother's Day is quickly approaching, and we want to honor our mothers who are with us and those who have passed. We are asking members to send clear photos or short video tributes of their mothers to office@newlifepresatl.com by Tuesday, May 5th. These items will be included in a special tribute at the end of our online Mother's Day service. And to all our mothers, we love you.
Praise the Lord, New Life. What a day of rejoicing and what a day for praising the Lord. We want you to realize today that even in the midst of this that we're going through, that our God is greater. Our God is stronger. Our God is higher than anything else going on in our lives. I hope this ministers to you. Hope this blesses you real good. Yes, it. We bless you, God. We bless you, God. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Water. Out of the ashes we rise. Come on.
Out of the darkness you shine.
And out of the ashes we rise.
Stop us, and if our God is with us, then what can stand?
There's no sickness.
And if our God
there's nothing that could stand against us. And we love you, and we praise you, we give you glory, that nothing can stand against us, God. Because you're greater than any situation. Lord, you are higher than any other. Our God's healer, awesome in power. Our God, he's our God, and he's defending you. Our God is defending us. He's looking out for us. Don't be concerned, don't be worried. Put your trust in him. He's looking out for you. We plead the blood of Jesus over all of your lives. Our God is worthy. Our God is higher. God bless you. We love you. We love you. We love you. Stay strong.
Good morning, New Life. And hello to the community of believers who have chosen to worship with us this morning. I praise God because it is an absolute privilege for me to share just a few minutes what I hope will be healing for our mental, spiritual, and emotional well-being. As a community, as we continue to navigate through this COVID-19 pandemic, I'm here this morning to remind each of us that if we haven't already, we must start to acknowledge and process our grief. Grief is the pain and emotional turmoil that comes when you lose someone or something that means everything to you. Grief can include a loved one who has died, the loss of a job, learning you have a serious illness, or even having to sell your home. Community, as we navigate through this pandemic, be gentle with yourself. As your soul begins the grieving process, be gentle with yourself. When you feel numb while watching the news, it's just your defense mechanism helping you process the pain. And community, sometimes we have to just sit with each other in uncomfortable silence as we grieve. Be gentle with yourself. When denial gradually fades away and reality comes in, and maybe you start questioning God or trying to find the meaning of life. And community, when you're in these deep places of doubt, let's just pray for one another. We are grieving. Just be gentle with yourself. When acceptance comes, and it will come, and your heart is broken, and you're feeling powerless, we may need to just sit with each other. Sit with each other over the phone or send sweet messages of encouragement. It's the process of our soul healing. Many of you know, in the midst of this pandemic, my husband's mother died in South Africa. And like many of you, our grieving process at times still feels unbearable. And yet, we have been undergirded with love by our New Life community. The leadership and church members have called and sent texts and prayed for us. You see, we are all one community. Y'all, we are grieving together through this pandemic. Let us continue to support each other, to grieve together, and to heal together. Thank you so much.
Special thanks to our very own Jean York and Deidre Hicks as they both made masks for our local community. Being the generous person that she is, Jean supplied Deidre with several pieces of fabric and lining, and they both began making masks. Jean suggested using yellow elastic as a sign of hope for those who received the mask. It is New Life's hope that the mask will continue to serve as a reminder of God's provision and protection during this time. Also, special thanks to Elder Charles Jenkins for delivering the mask to the following organizations: Southern Regional Medical Center, WellStar Atlanta Medical South, Clifton Sanctuary Ministries, and Love Beyond Walls. New Life, we ask that you please remember those on our prayer list: Elder George Lawson, Mr. Robert Mays, Dr. Sophia Coley, Dr. Morris Clark, Elder Margaret Mullen, Mr. Henley Black, Mrs. Gloria W. Gleason, Mrs. Jane Moyer, Ms. Talitha Brown, Mrs. Vivian Thurston, Ms. Rhoda Tolbert, the family of Howard and Cheryl Walton, the family of Melvin McCoy. We pray God's strength, comfort, and healing upon them.
Well, God bless your New Life. We're so glad to be here again. Just look at somebody next to you in your house that's sharing this broadcast with you and tell them, I made it. I'm still here. In spite of everything that's going on, in spite of the COVID, in spite of being at home and not being able to go anywhere, in spite of all the sickness and disease in our community, God, I'm still here. We made it. I made it. I've made it this far. I hope this is a blessing to you.
Another day's journey. I've made it through
another day's journey.
Another day's journey.
God kept me here.
Hallelujah, hallelujah. This is my testimony. Describe the grace of God that I'm standing here today. He was always there, no matter what came my way. He's a present help in the time of my need. He was standing right there just to see about me. I made it. Yes, I did.
Another day's journey.
I'm so glad.
God kept me here.
I'm so glad. God kept me here.
I made it through
another day's journey.
God kept me here.
I'm so glad about it. I'm so glad.
I made it. I'm still here.
Oh, touch somebody and tell them I made it. Yes, I did.
I'm still here.
The devil tried to take me out, but I'm so glad I made it. Jesus, for keeping me.
I made it.
God, you've been a keeper.
Yes, I made it.
In the good times and in the bad times.
I'm still here.
Through it all, I made it. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. God bless you, God bless you. We made it.
Good morning, family, and welcome to worship on this Sunday. I ask that you would journey with me to Samuel, 1 Samuel, chapter 13, verses 19 through 22. Now there were no smiths to be found throughout all the land of Israel. For the Philistines said, "The Hebrews must not make swords or spears for themselves." So all the Israelites went down to the Philistines to sharpen their plowshare, mattocks, axes, or sickles. The charge was 2/3 of a shekel for the plowshares or for the mattocks, and 1/3 of a shekel for sharpening the axes and for getting the goads. So on the day of battle, neither sword nor spear was to be found in the possession of any of the people with Saul and Jonathan. But Saul and his son Jonathan had them. This morning, for a brief moment, I want to deal with the subject, how to counter the conspiracy. If you would pray with me this morning, God of our weary years, God of our silent tears, we come to you this morning in need of a word that inspires us, uplifts us, and encourages us, O God, to be who you have called and created us to be. I pray now, Lord, that you will use me as I share with those who are watching this morning your words that I believe, Lord, you have given me for such a time as this. Bless now those under the sound of my voice. It is in your name I do pray. Amen. In our text this morning, we find Saul and his men headed out to battle with the Philistines. In 1 Samuel chapter 13 through 14, we encounter Saul and his son Jonathan engaged in a fight with the Philistines, an insurgent country that came to power after defeating the sons of Eli. The Philistines were the rulers of the land, and Saul and Jonathan were members of the oppressed community. The text tells us that much of Saul's 3,000 man army dwindles to 600 men. After this, many of them became fearful of defeat, and many of the soldiers, the Bible reads, fled and head to pits and caves and holes and cisterns to avoid confrontation with the Philistines. Why were they so afraid? What caused them to run and hide away? This oppressive regime sought to conquer the Hebrews and place them in captivity. Therefore, Saul and his men go out to fight for their freedom, only to realize how ill-prepared they are for battle. And I can only imagine the anxiety in the hearts of this community when they arrived at the conclusion that they were not prepared to fight. Their lives are being threatened and they are not prepared for battle. The text gives us the impression that they had not even been planning for battle. And I remember growing up hearing the wise words of elders when they would say, if you fail to plan, then you're planning to fail. And those of you listening this morning are keenly aware of the fact that before success, there must be preparation. Those of you watching this morning who are matriculating through the walls of academia, you know that passing the exam requires preparation. For the athletes listening and watching this morning, you know that if you want to win, then you have to put in the work. Before you get on the court or the field, in order to get the results you are looking for, you have to put in the work. Adults listening this morning who are looking to retire one day, you are aware that the lack of planning will probably keep you from experiencing the retirement you desire. And it's no dig on Walmart, but if you don't put a plan in place, you may be the individual standing at the front door saying, "Welcome to Walmart." The community in our text this morning was not prepared for a battle that could cost them their lives. And right now, family, I need you to hear me more than ever. Right now in our African-American communities across this country, we are engaged in a battle for our lives. This pandemic has exposed and placed on display this country's inequities and neglectful treatment of people of color and the poor. This moment in our history has revealed a country where the wealthy and corporations are bailed out before we can guarantee that children don't have to be dependent upon school lunches for their survival. This moment has shown us how a country, despite the valiant effort of our ancestors, is still segregated. We have seen just how separate and unequal health care is in our communities of color. We have seen how pre-existing conditions are conditional and depend on your zip code and area code. This crisis has also awakened the African-American community to the reality that we are not prepared for the battle at hand. COVID-19 has also shown us that America is still willing to sacrifice the lives of black folk for the sake of capitalism. This government is willing to let us die for the dollar, just as they commodified the bodies of our ancestors for the purpose of growing this economy. They are still willing to do the same today. Just this week, family, you heard the words yourself from the governor of this state, who stood before us like his plantation-owning relatives and said, "Negroes, go back to work." That's my version. That's what I heard on the television screen. Go put your life on the line for the sake of Georgia's economy. Kelly Loeffler and her husband, who is a founder and the CEO of the Intercontinental Exchange and other wealthy elites, were more concerned with the state's profits than they were the people of this state. Understanding how much the black community spends in beauty and cosmetics, which is another sermon for another day, they decided to open barbershops and beauty salons this weekend and place the lives of our people in jeopardy. For some strange reason, family, they thought that we were just that vain, that we would rush out of our homes for shape-ups and sew-ins and put our lives on the line. Why? Because our standard of beauty has been based on Eurocentric
ideals, but that's a sermon for another day. Our natural hair's not good enough. We can't even cornrow and plait, as my grandmother used to say. We're too embarrassed to look like who we are, and as a result, some of us are willing to risk our lives to look like something else. Like the community in this text, family, we're not ready for this battle. COVID-19 has a whole lot of us looking like Kevin Hart saying, no, I wasn't ready. This community was not ready in the text. This question, the question we have to ask, though, is why were they not prepared? For some strange reason, they had grown complacent with the way things were. And when this moment of crisis arose, they found themselves unable to rise to the occasion. Not only does it appear that they were complacent, but it appears that they were under the impression that something of this nature and magnitude was not possible. They didn't believe that there were some Philistines out there conspiring to disarm them and destroy them. And before you think that I'm suggesting that COVID-19 is the conspiracy, no, that's a pandemic we're experiencing. But the result of the systemic racism in this country has placed our people in a vulnerable position, and this crisis has shown that there has been a systematic way in which they have tried to break down the African American community. Look at the text. The Philistines said, the Hebrews, which means wanderers, must not make swords or spears for themselves. So all the Israelites went down to the Philistines to sharpen their plowshares, mattocks, axes, or sickles. What this passage suggests to us is that the Hebrews were not aware of the plans of the Philistines. The Hebrews interpreted their relationship with them as benevolence or some sort of kindness on the part of the Philistines. However, the text lets us know, we get to peek into what's going on, that the Philistines had an ulterior motive, that they were conspiring against the Hebrews all along. And I do believe that there were some folk in the community, like there are in our communities, that cautioned the people and said, I don't know about this. You need to stop going down there sharpening those tools. You better create your own. Don't put all your trust in those people. No doubt these people were labeled conspiracy theorists, because that's what we do when folks in our community try to enlighten us and speak truth about the realities of depending so much on people who don't have our best interests in mind. We always label them as conspiracy theorists. We say they're too radical. As a result, these truth tellers and bearers of wisdom are disregarded and our communities wander and meander down paths of destruction. And using the word conspiracy, mostly always people start to think something crazy, like an individual is out of their minds. We believe conspiracies are associated with those who believe in extraterrestrial life or something outlandish. But I'm here today to let you know that conspiracy is real in this country. Most of the time, people who mention the word conspiracy are dismissed because the average American does not believe that this government engages in or allows conspiracies to happen. Travel with me down the road of history. America wants people to believe that this country didn't conspire to own Africans and keep them in a system of forced servitude. They don't want us to believe that they use vagrancy laws to lock up black men and sentence them to life in working in coal mines for the rest and remainder of their lives. Most people didn't believe that an American government was injecting black men in Tuskegee, Alabama with syphilis and watching them die in the mid-1900s. They don't want us to believe that thousands of African-American women were intentionally sterilized in the state of North Carolina from 1929 to 1974 through the state's eugenic sterilization program, and that North Carolina just was one of the many states that systematically targeted poor and disenfranchised women by forcing them into having total hysterectomies. Or was in 1927. When a Supreme Court upheld forced sterilization law, and Justice Oliver Wendell Holmes wrote the majority decision, which stated, it is better for a world if instead of waiting to execute degenerate offspring for crime, or to let them starve from their imbecility, society can prevent those who are manifestly unfit for continuing their kind. They don't want us to believe that conspiracy to strip our communities of the right to vote by redrawing lines and removing polling sites, or that prison industrial systems target underachieving school districts to calculate how many prisons they are needed to build while being supported by state governments. They don't want us to believe that. They don't want us to believe that, in this pandemic, our communities are the last to be tested, even though we make up the majority of frontline workers in many cities across this country. Many people would tell you, family, there's no such thing as a conspiracy in this country. People don't sit around plotting and scheming such things. Most Americans either don't believe or don't care that for 100 years, many banks and housing authorities contrived to deny people of color the right to purchase a home or buy in a neighborhood deemed white. And like South Africa, America, American municipalities and local governments funded people of color, funneled people of color into neighborhoods they decided were best for them. They don't want us to believe that the same maps they use for redlining are the same maps they use to decide where toxic waste dumps and refineries were placed. Well, Pastor, why are you preaching this today? I want to hear a message that tells me I'm going to be all right. I want to hear a message that says I can survive in the wilderness. I want to hear a message that this too shall pass. And I know some of us want to hear those kinds of messages, and they are valid and valuable to our faith. However, I hear the Lord calling me to move from the pastoral to the prophetic. Why? Because if we are to survive and thrive, there are some hard realities that we need to come to grips with real quick. And there are some things we need to build and create. Because contrary to popular opinion, we'll never go back to things as usual. And if we do, meaning African American, if we go back to what was, then shame on us. Because this country has shown us, and this pandemic has shown us what we need to do and where the work needs to begin. This is the sad reality of the world we live in and the country we live in. And just like in our text this morning, we see how a community of people acquiesced their power, and as a result, they played right into the hands of the conspiracy that was designed to destroy them. The story becomes a lesson on how oppressed people and marginalized people should never render themselves powerless by becoming dependent on systems that don't have their best interests in mind. In verse 19, it says that there were no blacksmiths in all the land of Israel. And I don't have time to go into the history of blacksmiths in African American community. However, I will say this, and history is my witness. This ancient trade was brought to America by slaves from the west coast of Africa. Our people were the first civilization that created iron workers. And this trade can be traced back to the 13th century in Mali, and some of the oldest shops where these Africans continued the trade in America under forced labor are located in Alexandria, Virginia. During slavery and the years after, the blacksmiths were needed, and it was a very lucrative vocation for black men in America. And in our text this morning, we see that blacksmiths not only made swords, but they sharpened the plows that they used to plow the fields, the axes they used to cut lumber, which they used to build homes, and sickles they used to clear the land. And in this agricultural society, this trade was vital for communities, and the Philistines strategically took their tools so that they could control the community's economy. What Israel used to do for themselves, they now had to depend on the Philistines to do for them. Many of you grew up at a time when we didn't have to depend on some of the things we depend on now. You grew up in a time where our communities produced what we needed for our survival and for our thriving. A trade and a tradition that once existed in the community in this biblical text has become obsolete because they now depend on the Philistines. Their dependency has rendered them powerless. This is the case in so many of our communities. We can't fight the things that are destroying us because we're dependent. We no longer do for ourselves what we used to do. We can't fight obesity and all other matter of sickness because we no longer own the stores in our communities. Therefore, we can't control the food that comes into our communities. We can't control the restaurants that populate our communities. And it's hard to fight poorly funded education and miseducation when we've handed the education of our children over to people who don't care for us. It's hard to fight poverty, the kind of poverty that we see in our inner cities and many of our rural communities, when we've handed our communities over to people who don't have our best interests in mind. And this pandemic is showing us that, like the Hebrews, we have no blacksmiths. The folk that used to grow, build, and protect our communities no longer exist. Like major corporations in America, family, we have outsourced our well-being and placed it in the hands of people who have historically raped and pillaged our communities. Oh, not in Atlanta, you say. We have black leaders. But hear this, black faces do not equate to a black agenda. When the colonizer teaches you to think like him or her, he does not have to occupy seats of power in order for his agenda to be accomplished. As long as he has taught the colonized to think like him, then his system of oppression will always exist. And there are too many of us out there who are thinking like colonizers and not thinking like those who are liberated and fighting for the liberation of the least, the left, and the lost out. The colonizer will be like a master puppeteer who pulls the strings, but is hidden in the shadows. But you see, folks like Patrice Lumumba, Kwame Nkrumah, and Malcolm X, and others understood this. So did the CIA, and that's why they killed them. Because those individuals understood that if we could change the consciousness of black folk to understand the importance of creating for themselves and building for themselves, then we could shape and build what many of us love to quote and say all the time. We can build our own Wakanda. But we can't do that when we have an oppressor's mentality, when we have a colonized mind. We can only do that when we understand the resources that are all around us, when we understand that supporting our communities of color and supporting our businesses and making sure that our dollar circulates in our community, it's only then that a Wakanda is ever possible. But how is it that the community in this biblical text became comfortable depending on their enemy to supply them with what they needed to survive? If we are to counter the conspiracy, the plots and the plans of those who try to destroy our people, then we must not be dependent on those same people for our existence. But secondly, if we're going to counter the conspiracy, then we must all realize that everybody should have what they need to engage in battle. I'm almost done, but hear me when I say this. The text tells us that Saul and Jonathan had swords. Don't miss that. Saul and Jonathan had swords. In many of our communities, we have adopted that idea of leadership, that there's a singular leader who ultimately possesses all the power. And leaders have bought into this ideal. Furthermore, we have traded our values of being communal for an individualistic culture that is pervasive in this place called America. We now have this mentality that says, I have mine, now you have to get yours. In striving for our existence, we have abandoned communal living. If we're to come out of this pandemic differently, family, then we must answer the question posed to us years ago by the National Association of Color Women. How do I lift as I climb? How can I come up? How can my come up lift others up? Why did it take so long in this text for Saul and Jonathan to realize that their community was not prepared to fight? They didn't even know that the men in the community were unarmed and not ready for battle. Why? Because a lot of people who call themselves leaders fail to realize that leadership means empowering others. With all the churches and organizations around this country that populate black communities, we are finding out that people are still not being empowered through education. And as a result, they are unprepared when crisis arises. And we are squandering and meandering and asking and pleading for salvation when part of our salvation can come from understanding our own power and worth. Saul and Jonathan should have known long before this event, that their people were not prepared. They were not connected to the people. And it is a shame when you have leadership that's not connected to the pulse of the people. And they had grown dependent on their enemies. If we're going to counter the conspiracy, then we must have leadership that empowers all and makes sure that all are equipped to fight. And I'm not talking about warfare. I'm talking about equipping people to go out into the world and fight for their well-being, to fight for their shalom. This community was suffering because they were no longer teaching a trade that was needed for their survival. And just like them, we have abandoned many teachings in our community that can aid in survival, in our survival, and prepare us for when crisis arises. We are in need of blacksmiths, those who grow, build, protect our communities. We're in need of blacksmiths in the form of teachers who teach our young about their history while affirming their ability to be great. We need blacksmiths in the form of black banks that in time of crisis we can count on not to look us over. If our ancestors could create Black Wall Street, why can't we? We need to circulate our resources in our communities, and we need blacksmiths like Stacey Abrams and other leaders who have the heart of the people in mind. We also need to support these blacksmiths. It's time out for us thinking that our only way to survive in this country is to become less of who we are and more like white America. Stop believing that the education at white institutions is better than that at black colleges and universities. Yes, they are different and they have their challenges, but that's usually a result of our lack of support to the institutions that advanced our people. We need a community of blacksmiths, women and men, who are consciously building and empowering people of color. Folks, I'm done. I hope you have seen and realized that the Calvary isn't coming to save us. We must save ourselves. May this be a time of renewed commitment to become less dependent on economic and political systems that have abandoned and abused us. I pray you're planning your business endeavor right now while you're in isolation at your home. I hope you're planning how to build your wealth. I hope you're learning to grow your own food and finding African-American businesses you can support on the other side of this pandemic, or even in the midst of it. Today, at the conclusion of this sermon, I'm inviting you to our website to see our Black Business Portal, to see where we are trying to connect community with people who look like us, who are doing the work in our communities, who have credible businesses that we can support. If you're one of those individuals listening and watching today, I encourage you to go to our website, connect and send your information, that we might add you as a resource and circulate it to our community. We counter the conspiracy when we take control of our communities and our environment, not to be segregated from the rest of the world,
but to say that our focus is on building what America has tried to break. Family, in this time and in this season, let us consciously commit ourselves to doing for ourselves, supporting our communities, and growing to be even better on the other side of this crisis. God bless you. Again, I'd like to thank all of you who have tuned in today to our broadcast and who have supported our ministry. I specifically today want to thank all of the many members and friends of New Life who have so courageously stepped up during this challenging time and shown your support for our ministry. Your gifts, your time, your talents, even from your own homes, are valued and appreciated by our session leadership and myself. For those of you who have been creating masks for our frontline workers, we're so grateful. For those of you who are committing to volunteer your time to serve food to the hungry in our community, we're grateful. We thank you so much for continuing to be the church and recognizing that we might not be in the sanctuary, but we're still called to be disciples of Christ. If you're watching today and you're not a part of a ministry, I want to invite you to connect with us. You don't have to live in the state of Georgia. We invite you to, wherever you are remotely, to be a member of this community where we can support you. You can join us during the week for our Wednesday Bible studies. You can also participate in our monthly prayer calls. We invite you to support this ministry by going to our online website and giving and paying close attention to the prompts that will come after I've spoken, to text to give and support our ministry in other ways. Again, I'm so grateful for all of you. I thank you for watching and witnessing this service today, and I pray that it inspires you and creates in you a fire and burning desire to be all God has created you to be. God bless.
Due to the recent impact of the coronavirus, all members are asked to join us each Sunday at 10:30 a.m. for our live stream broadcast. New Life, Pastor Williams values each and every member of our congregation, and for that reason, we have chosen to limit the congregation's exposure by hosting online services. In addition, members are asked to continue supporting the ministry of New Life by giving via our online platforms. You may give through your mobile device by texting hashtag fund to 470-202-0808. A message will appear prompting you to click the link to complete your giving. You may sign on to our website at www.newlifepressatl.com and click on Give Today. If you'd like to create a giving profile to track your giving, create a profile on the giving page. You can also give via our mobile app. Go to your Apple or Google App Store to select our New Life Church app. Please make sure that your selected app has our church logo on it, as there are many options to choose from. Once downloaded, follow the prompts to set up your profile and select Give to make your donation. You may also mail your donation. Please make your check or money order payable to the New Life Presbyterian Church and mail it to New Life Presbyterian Church, P.O. Box 491-237, Atlanta, Georgia 30349. May God bless and keep you all. Please stay in touch by tuning in to our Sunday online services and Noonday Wednesday online devotions. Please stay in touch by tuning in to our Sunday online services and our Wednesday noon online devotions. To access our online service, please visit our website at www.newlifepresatl.com. Click on Live Stream, and near the bottom of the blue box, click the Watch Again button. These have been your Sunday morning announcements. Have a blessed and safe week. And New Life, always remember to bless, bloom, become.